Tony Abbott went to China this week and told the country he'd like it to be more democratic. And the opposition leader said he had a problem with investment here by companies controlled by the Chinese regime.
It would rarely be in Australia's interest to allow a foreign government or its agencies to control an Australian business. That's because we don't support the nationalisation of business by the Australian government, let alone by a foreign one.
Foreign Minister Bob Carr was outraged.
He is striking in three or four of the things he said about China, what can only be seen, and which will be seen by them, I think, as an adversarial approach with China. And I think that is reckless. I think it is really dangerously dumb.
Joining me are former Immigration Minister Amanda Vanstone and former New South Wales Health Minister John Della. John, I'm a little bit puzzled by Bob Carr's outrage. So what did Tony Abbott actually do that was wrong?
I think it was pretty understated outrage by the foreign minister, so I don't think it was
dangerously dumb.
I don't think that's understated. Well, we'd have to wait a while for Bob to wind up. But look, the bottom line on this is that people do have to treat with care when they're the opposition leader. I think it's legitimate for the opposition leader in Australia to make remarks about foreign policy. It's a little bit dangerous to go to China and start making pronouncements about foreign policy as the opposition leader.
But what was the foreign policy thing that he said wrong?
Well, I'm about to get to that, Andrew. I actually personally think it's about time that people did start ringing the bell on the democracy issue in China. I don't have a problem with that. In fact, I think that's quite appropriate for all the leadership of any of the Australian political parties. And it is a legitimate thing to say that China has benefited from many of the aspects of the Western economy. And one of the things that the Western economy has thrived on most of the time in our history is democracy.
So it sounds like you're agreeing with what Bob Carr says was dangerously dumb.
Well, I think there's an inconsistency, though, also in the trade issue, because there are lots and lots of governments that have interests in enterprises that invest in Australia, and they're not all communist governments.
Well, honestly, give me a break. Carr's Prime Minister, in her first overseas trip, I think it was, made the announcement she wasn't really interested in foreign affairs.
She'd rather be sitting in a classroom.
Yeah, rather be sitting in a classroom. So, you know, are we being critical of an opposition leader who goes to China and states the obvious? Democracy is a good thing.
Yes.
And if you want to invest here, by the way, we have a Foreign Investment Review Board. And, you know, we watch reasonably carefully what happens with our assets, as indeed do most other countries. No big deal. I mean, I don't think Bob Carr's in any position to be nitpicking with what other people say. He's made his own.
You'd have to be right in worrying, wouldn't you, John, about state-owned enterprises by a government like China's, which is not democratic, and these state-owned enterprises don't operate in normal market rules, buying whole businesses in Australia. You'd have to have a bit of scrutiny on
now
that.
I hide myself behind Amanda's position. We do have a Foreign Investment Review Board. And of course,
I'm still struggling with
my point.
Well, I think I did say, I think it was about time people started putting their hand up when we relate to China about the issue of democracy and human rights. And I don't think that's the problem.
About time. How the problem is the way in which human rights dialogue with China.
I think that's
China.
The problem is the way it's done. And I think that was the only reservation I have. But I also say it's a little bit hypocritical to talk about the economic aspects, because the government of Singapore, the government of Saudi Arabia, the government of a whole range of investors in Australia, or potential investors in Australia, have substantial interests or outright own enterprises that are investing in Australia.
Well, look, if one of them goes sour, I don't mind having a confrontation with the Singaporean government. If I have a confrontation with the Chinese government, that's just suddenly a bigger, far bigger issue. But listen, it's interesting, isn't it? Tony Abbott met the Indonesian president recently. He then went to the US leadership dialogue and meeting top people there. And now in China, that's a deliberate strategy to broaden his image, is it not?
Well, I would have thought it's a sensible thing to do. I mean, the polling indicates that he's going to be Australia's next Prime Minister. Mm. Things can happen, I understand that. No one should guarantee anything in their head. But you'd be a fool not to prepare yourself. And one way to prepare yourself is to expand into areas that you might not have spent a lot of time on in the past. So getting to know leaders in our region, leaders that are important to us, like our allies, the United States, China and Indonesia, is a very important step. I think it's a good thing.
It's little about foreign affairs. It's really, it's been a foreign territory to him, almost literally. But do you think this going to work, this idea of Abbott the statesman? Do you think people will buy that?
Well, look, I think obviously the politics of this is, I think, pretty straightforward. Tony Abbott's, on the basis of the polling, as Amanda said, is you know, probably firm in the betting for to be the next Prime Minister of Australia. But he does have some serious problems. As an opposition leader, he has a net satisfaction rating which is, you know, close to a record low. It is not without precedent that opposition leaders have poor standings.
So you agree
and then
that Gillard's got a serious problem, do you? Because her satisfaction rating's around the same level. So I think I'm
on the record saying
Gillard
that there's a problem. That
very serious problem.
But I'm not necessarily saying that for either Tony Abbott or for Julie Gillard, this problem is necessarily fatal. But staying with Tony Abbott for a second, this is obviously a strategy to broaden out his image, to get away from some of the domestic negativity, etc., that he's fessed up to being characterised by.
I think it's an interesting change for him. Job losses this week, John, there were quite a few. The one probably that caught the main headlines was the closing of the Kurnell refinery, 300 jobs gone, which is very sad for the people involved. It's switching from refining the oil itself to importing it from bigger refineries, more efficient ones in Asia. I was amazed by the AWU boss Paul Howser's reaction. Very worrying for a start. He wants shoppers to tell Woolworths that its petrol outlet, which uses Caltex fuel, should not use foreign fuel instead. Ever listen to him?
When you fill up in future at a Woolworths petrol bowser, you are not using the Australian fuel people, you are using the foreign fuel people.
Now listen, forcing Woolies to put pressure on Caltex to keep open a refinery that loses $200 million a year, this is crazy. What sort of union movement is this?
Well, I don't know if he was saying that. I mean, I think he was
making a point
of frustration about job losses and the reason why there's job losses. Obviously, he's got to advocate for members that have just lost their jobs.
Consumer boycott of Woolies.
Well, he didn't actually advocate a consumer boycott of Woolies, and I'm sure if he's going to he's going to have to kind of get a little bit more social media going and a whole lot of resources to have any impact on Woolies. So I don't think that's where the union is really going. I think it's one of those statements that's made
for the members, you know,
to demonstrate what the problem is.
But Amanda, this seems to fit into a sort of pattern. Howes also called on the government to threaten Chevron, which is a Caltex shareholder, implying it should threaten its $43 billion Gorgon gas project to keep Kurnell open. I mean, what's the strategy here? I mean, is he just doing it to appeal to members?
I think his strategy is publicity for himself with his members. I think I can be forgiven for assuming that this guy thinks he belongs in federal parliament, where Julia Gillard now is. That's what he thinks. But if he does want to go there, he's going to have to understand there isn't a business leader in Australia that says we need to be a more productive nation. We need productivity improvement. And until we do that, while we keep paying ourselves a lot and not making ourselves more productive, guess what? Investment's going to go somewhere else. It's just that
simple. You've put your finger
on
it. There's a tension here between the AWU being a major power broker in federal politics and also just wanting to fight for its members. And I think this is what's being exposed here. John, on the National Disability Insurance Scheme, now you're now the campaign director of Every Australian Counts, which is a lobby group advocating for the NDIS. Julia Gillard, has she had a big win today? I mean, this week, convincing New South Wales and Victoria, despite their initial opposition, to chip in some money for this trial?
Well, the most important thing for me as campaign director of Every Australian Counts is that people with a disability, Australians with a disability, had a big win, and Australia had a big win because we make the first steps towards really addressing the huge deficit in the way in which Australians with a disability are supported at the moment and for the last two generations or so. So that's the first thing. That's the people who've had the win by making sure this is better done. It was a bit unseemly that we had a lot of hectoring and a lot of bickering between the premiers and the prime minister and the Commonwealth states. But then again, the politician in me, well, I'm not really a politician anymore, but having a firm memory of ministerial councils past and COAG's past, nothing new in that. 111 years, the Commonwealth states have been bickering about money.
And boy, would she gain from a win. But Amanda, the thing that worried me was two-thirds of that $1 billion just for the trial is in administration. That is an amazing amount.
It is a serious worry. I used to be the disability minister once, and I do think that the states always try. I'm sure they do. I don't think I know. They always try and get the Commonwealth to pay more, and that's a bit unattractive. Equally unattractive, I would have thought, on this sort of issue, is the Prime Minister not trying in the very beginning to get a bipartisan approach. There's a little bit of card playing here, look at me, you know, I care for the more disadvantaged people in the community, with the implication that others don't. I think that's unattractive. But look, in any government spending, what you have to look at is what's going on in admin, what's going on public servants. You need public servants. They can do a really good job, but you've got to get the balance right, and that's a hell of a lot of money on administration. Put it another way, how much is actually going into disability services? That's what'll make the difference.
$350 million. Amanda Vanstone, John Della Bosca, thank you so much for joining me.